R. Oxford from West Hills. Thank you very much. And I see that Susan Wickham and Susan Glossett Farrelly from Fullerton and Oxford and Krista Bailey and Aline Solis is here from Cal State East Bay. So welcome and thank you for joining us today. So Teresa, thank you for turning on the recording feature. So this webinar will be recorded and will be posted on our website. And we will repeat this webinar again, I think in mid-April, and then again, maybe perhaps later on in those few months before the RFP needs to be turned in by June 30th, so that if folks have any additional questions and or want to follow up, they can do that. But I'd like to point out really quickly that if anybody has any questions at any time, we have an email which I'm going to type into the chat room, chat feature. Well, that should be edu. coolfored@cdl.edu. And maybe, Teresa, you could type the correct one for me, please, where you can send inquiries or ask us to review your campus plan, and all of that will be taken care of by me. It comes right to me, that email, and then also I will share it with our chair of the California OER Council. Her name is Kathy Harris, to provide assistance if it is that you ask for some review on your campus plan before you turn it in. So today's webinar is going to focus on that plan, and I thought what I would do would be to share my computer, and so that's what I'm going to do. And if it, let's see if that works for you all as well. And right now you should be seeing the campus plan in the window, and perhaps you could do another check mark, or if you could, if you guys have checked it, so just to verify that you're seeing the campus plan in your window on your screen. And also, if you have any questions in the next hour or so, there's a little hand next to the check mark, and if you click on that, that sounds a little bit of a bell, and then that will alert me that you might have a question on that particular topic that we're focusing on at the time. So feel free to click on raising your hand. Okay, so I see that there are probably all of you or most of you are on the campus plan on your computer as well, which is great. So whatever works for you, you can be looking at this from your computer, or you could be looking at the screen, the Collaborate screen that I'm sharing. So, and also Teresa has included the link in the chat feature if that's, if you need to click on that to go look at it there. So we're going to go through the tabs at the bottom of the plan. You'll see that there are several tabs, and just to explain some of the aspects of it, the expectations of information that is included in this plan. And then, as I said, if you have any questions, please let me know. So, so the first page, or the tab, is the overview tab, and we just are asking you to include your campus name and that kind of information, kind of an overview of your institution, which will be very interesting to know. Not necessarily that important to have that information that will make a difference. So, for example, if your campus strategic priority that aligns with 798, if you don't have one for whatever reason, that's not going to impact your abilities to participate. It's just sometimes this is a good process for an institution to kind of think through whether or not there are some strategic goals within the organization or the institution that align with an initiative such as AB 798, the College Textbook Affordability Plan. And so that's the intention there. And this also could help with getting some discussion started on your campus if it hasn't already happened with regards to how strategic priorities are pointing back to student affordability, which is what this is all about. So let me ask you for your project objectives. What are you thinking you're going to do with this funding in order to help your students eventually get access to more affordable course materials? So there's no right or wrong answer. Again, it's to help you plan for this initiative and to show us, the council, I'm not a member of the council, but I am the co-manager of it. So, and the council will be reviewing these campus plans. These are, and let me just define what the council is in case you don't know that. There was another legislation called SB 1052, passed in 2012, and the Senate Bill 1052, which set up a council of faculty that were to establish the coolfored.org site and also to select the textbooks and facilitate the peer reviews of those textbooks, and hopefully you've gone and seen the coolfored.org site. That council, through AB 798, has been designated as the reviewers of the campus plans. And each, so the council is made up of three representatives from each higher ed organization in the state of California, so community colleges, the California State University, and then the University of California. And that's the current makeup of the California OER Council. And as I mentioned, they will be the reviewers of the plans after they're submitted. So this information will help them just to determine awarding any institution their requested amount, and then also, so as much as one can fill this in as possible, will be very helpful for the council to understand what the your institution's project objectives. Or I'm scrolling down now to the measures of the success that you're going to look into or determine, such as here we have an example of the number of course section adoptions, the dollars saved per section, number of professional development and outreach events, and the estimated number of attendees you might see at these events. Now, realizing that this is a planning document, that these are ideas and objectives that you are creating, but we will understand if not all of them will be 100% either met or if the objectives or the measures of success change a little bit depending on the reality of the implementation process. So I'm scrolling down. There's a campus readiness as well. So listing the existing aspects of your campus culture. Again, this is a process of to think through all these various components that do usually have some, will impact or will have something to do with a campus receiving funds and then implementing these funds within the aspects of the faculty and the students and all the other activities that might be needed to support this initiative. So that could be resources, support services. What all do you have in regards to your campus readiness for this? So this is an opportunity to share what your brainstorm or what you consider as a group on your campus as to your campus readiness for this initiative. And then also any of the challenges, again, for your organization to think through some of these issues which could affect the impact and the success of this initiative. Hopefully you can maybe even put into place a way to address those issues, the challenges that could be coming along because of the this new, possibly new initiative at your institution. So that's why we're asking for your campus challenges, your readiness, your project objectives, et cetera, et cetera. So I'm scrolling back up just to cover, to review and or ask if you have any questions about the overview tab. And I don't hear anybody raising their hands, so I'm going to move on. So the project team tab focuses on who's part of this project. So it's recommended that it's not a single person who's leading the initiative, that there could be a collaborative group that is formed, maybe an ad hoc committee that is formed and or on the CSUs, because my job in the CSU is to direct the Affordable Learning Solutions Initiative, and we have already a structure on most of our campuses where there is a committee of sorts that is working together to consider different types of activities in regards to helping faculty become aware, discover, and even adopt open or low-cost resources. So We'd like to hear or to see what you have on your campus in regards to potential project partners. Again, this can change as you go through your implementation process. We recommend that you include a librarian, possibly someone from your library, maybe a reference librarian, somebody that's part of your instructional design or technical support team. Possibly somebody from your bookstore, because bookstores can also have also been very, very much involved in bringing the cost down for students through their buyback programs and rentals, and also their used books programs, and they could also be very helpful. Sometimes it's great to have a student on the committee or faculty members who are interested in participating. So, we're thinking about certain stakeholders on your campus that could be helpful to hear their voices in this project planning process. And then, because you'll need the documents, the campus plan signed off by someone on your campus, someone that is executive sponsor type, it would be a good idea that they know that you're submitting this plan for these funds, because that usually alerts the fiscal group on the campus that there could be an award being distributed to your institution, and so there usually is a process that's involved in that as well. So, again, a single person or a group of folks need to make sure that the executives and or, some sort of leadership folk on your campus are aware of the fact that you are submitting a campus plan and request for funding, because there are many triggers involved in that process of transferring of funds, of distributing funds, et cetera, and also so that they can be supportive of the initiative within the faculty governance structure and also among the students. So, most campuses that I'm aware of have a student senate, and including them in this so that they're aware of the initiative is very important and highly recommended as well. Just by way of background, I've been in the CSU for about 10 years, but in a previous life, I was a tenured faculty at a community college, Fullerton College. And I was on the academic senate there as well, so I'm somewhat familiar with the structures and the governance structures in the community colleges as well. So, as you know, this initiative also requires an academic senate resolution passed by the academic senate, and we have examples of that on our site. So that's also part of the awareness process on a campus, that the faculty governance group is aware of a potential initiative, and that this will then also contribute to the faculty, and then also hopefully the students, that there are opportunities to possibly lower the cost of their course materials. So this section of the spreadsheet is meant to address these types of issues that I just talked about, and these are just suggested rows. You don't have to fill all the rows in. We've got also at the bottom, you can add additional rows if needed. So any questions about the project team page or tab on this reporting template? Just going to scroll back up in case I need to prompt any questions. We do ask that your initiative is led by a designated coordinator, someone who is going to receive the communications from the program, from this initiative, from us. For example, the awards letter, and or the person that's going to be responsible to turn in the, in a year's time, there's a requirement to turn in an update or how are you doing kind of a report. So that coordinator person should be designated to do that. Okay, barring any other questions, I'm going to the Communications and Outreach tab. And the idea here is to help the institution that's planning to do this apply for the initiative to think about the potential stakeholders and what kind of value propositions that they can provide for this initiative, what the desired outcome or action could be, the activity that they could be responsible for or involved in, the timeline around that, and who that might be as a reasonable party, who will be accountable for that aspect of this spreadsheet to make it happen, and then what are the measures of success? What do you think is going to be a successful measure for whether or not you have some training, professional development training activities, or you have, is it going to be a number of departments that you're thinking about targeting or who are interested, et cetera, et cetera. So those are just suggestions at the top of the page. And I'm scrolling down now to the actual list of stakeholders that we've got listed here again. And this is, my page isn't scrolling very well. Let me see if I can do it this way. So these are just suggested participants or stakeholders. You don't have to, these are not all required, but as I mentioned earlier, we talked about the fact that we would recommend that you include a librarian, that the library dean might be aware of this activity because one of his or her librarians is involved, and that might be a part of what their job requirement is for the next few months or the next year. Or including faculty, of course, the faculty who are stepping forward to possibly participate. Or if you're not sure who might be the one to step forward or the faculty to step forward, then you might want to include department chairs because they could identify courses that could be used or sections of a single course that could be a part of this application process. So. And it's always good to let the president know that there's this initiative. And, we've tried our best to make sure that we communicate to the higher levels through the community college system and through the CSU. All of the presidents in the CSU have received notification and still have the provost. And I'm aware that in the community college system that there are the provost's role isn't necessarily that. So I'm going to write in a vice president of instruction or someone of that similar level, someone that's kind of managing the academic affairs side of a campus. Again, just to make sure that they're in the loop, that they can provide support and in various ways, or it's always a good idea just to let them know. Obviously, your Campus Academic Senate will be in the loop because they will be working on providing a resolution in regards to the AB 798 initiative. And we do have sample Academic Senate resolutions on the coolfored.org website. There is actually a very nice template that the community college faculty developed for the community colleges, so that hopefully will help the community college folks and could also be a guide for the CSU folks as well. We talked a little bit about faculty, about department chairs. There could be specific departments that are going to participate. For example, I talked to one campus and they said that their chemistry department has decided to select the OpenStax Chem book and they have 30 sections. So that means that minimally they can apply for $30,000 because they have 30 sections now of a single course, chemistry, and they're all adopting the OpenStax book. That's just an example, not a requirement for anyone to go to chemistry or to adopt OpenStax or many other resources out there, but that could be working with specific departments in that way. It's a great idea to involve your faculty development director, and I left that person off by mistake when I talked about project team people, because a lot of this initiative has to do with project workshops or professional development workshops. So it could be that it takes place as a collaboration with a faculty development group or director or with the instructional design group on your campus. Every campus is different how they're structured. So, these are just ideas. Again, as I said, if you have extended ed, you might want to include the dean or someone at that level to make sure that they're aware that you're applying for these funds and that you're going to be focusing on this initiative. In the CSU, a lot of the online courses are in the extended ed area. So, some of the online courses are going to be looking at using open textbooks, because and one reason is not only to save students money, but many times it's also a digital resource that students can get access to immediately. So that's sometimes why we recommend the extended ed dean. But we realize that plenty of courses that are involved are going to be face-to-face classes adopting these resources, so academic deans are just as important. I mentioned the library. CIO, the Chief Information Officer, is usually the person that runs the IT organization, and they could have an impact of who, from the instructional design side or the help desk, could be involved with being aware of your students now adopting certain digital textbooks, and that could provide some challenges in the way of students never having used a digital textbook before. They might be calling the help desk for assistance. The help desk doesn't necessarily need to know every book and be aware of every book that's available, but then just to be aware of the initiative, and that if they're getting a lot of calls on a particular book, then there might be a need to notify the faculty member that there are some issues, and that there might need to be some orientation on how to use a digital textbook in a course. So that's sometimes help desks and instructional designers point directly back to the CIO. And then some campuses have directors of academic technology. Sometimes they're separated from the IT organization. So same thing. The folks who are helping to promote and support technology in the classroom, online, all the academic technologies, it's good to make sure that they're aware of the fact that there is this initiative taking place and what their role could possibly be. It's a good idea to think that through. I mentioned the instructional designers. They're the ones that are really critical to this project. If you have them, to try to keep them in the loop and incorporate them into this planning process, because they are usually on the ground helping the faculty with their digital environment, whether that's the learning management system on your campus, which could be Blackboard or Canvas or Moodle and or Desire to Learn. They can be helping faculty embed links directly to the textbooks into their courses. What I've seen on the faculty showcase that we have on the CoolForEd.org site, when we ask about the faculty experiences with OER, a lot of times the struggles or the challenges they encounter are they aren't familiar with how to use a digital textbook, and so they struggle with how do I point to the page 36 or to a particular chapter and help the students find that as well. And the instructional designers can help with that, to embed that in their LMS so it's an easy click for the students and the instructors as well. Or even provide an orientation to the students about using a textbook in a digital environment. And I would recommend that we all remember that that's a critical component to the success of this project, because many students, in as much as we think of them as very technically savvy with their phones or their devices, have not used a digital textbook before. I teach a course at Long Beach State right now of teachers who are preparing to get their credential, and it's a technology course, and we just did a section on digital textbooks, and in that course, only 2 students out of 25 had ever used a digital textbook. So that was an interesting experience for them, not realizing that you can sometimes highlight activities, and you can save things, and you can search, and all the benefits of using digital and or the challenges was something that was reminded to me that students are, and oftentimes teachers have not had that experience, and it's not a bad thing. It's just a next step in their learning on using digital devices. All right, so VP of Student Services, you know, those are the folks that manage the student side of the organization or the institution. It might be good to have their buy-in or understanding of what is happening, because then they could be aware when the student governments are maybe putting forth resolutions, which we are seeing in the CSU. Student governments are asking or passing resolutions saying we'd like our faculty to be more aware of open textbooks or lowering the cost of materials, that they are aware of this initiative, because many, many, many folks are not aware of a textbook affordability initiative. And it's always good that the folks at the institution are as well. And then the director for the Center for Students with Disabilities, or in community college sometimes a CSPS, in the CSUs, the name varies, but every campus usually has a group or someone that's designated to help students who have sight impaired or hearing impaired or many different types of challenges in regards to their learning, their experiences. And so making sure that they're included, that they're aware of this initiative, that there could be alternatives to the textbook that's been selected, or if the student needs a special assistance, so that they have a heads up that they're going to be coming to them for that, or that they can also provide advice to that to be used in the professional development workshops, that the instructors are not caught unawares of the potential for students that might need some extra assistance there or guidance. And then the associate students, those are the student governments on your campuses. That, as I mentioned before, they can be a very strong supporter, and it's a great idea to include them. In fact, they were a very strong component to passing AB 798 at the state level. They were very much involved in that and really advocated for the affordability aspect for their textbooks, and understandably so. I mentioned the campus bookstore earlier. They can be quite helpful, and it's a good idea to collaborate with them. We do that quite a bit in CSU, and we see only good things out of that, so I highly recommend it. You might trigger the student newspaper because they could be writing articles of support and or keeping folks apprised of your process and this initiative and the implementation of it. You might have chief financial officers also, because they should actually be aware of the fact that there's going to be funds transferred to your campus, and then how they need to be then thinking of a process of distributing it to the various entities and whatever process that you consider and have designed for that on in your proposal. Financial aid office, it's a good idea to let them know just so that they're aware that there's this initiative. And then the faculty advisory, if you have a faculty technology committee, good idea. Academic advising, always good to let them know about this initiative. The Learning Assistance Center, those are usually the tutoring centers. Again, a student might come in and say, I don't know how to use this book. Not that that would be the best place to go with that for help with a book, but at least the Learning Assistance Center will be aware that something's different here, and that they will know what resources to go to for help with that, or they can help the student as well. Public affairs and development, external higher ed community, all good places, and other places we haven't thought of might be good places. Entities to include in your communications and outreach in this plan. Again, these are all not required. These are just recommended, and these are just part of your thinking and your thought process as you're thinking about how this initiative and the funding is going to impact your faculty and students in your campus in general. Any questions?
Lovely. Suzanne had a question.
Okay.
Yeah.
Let's see. I go ahead, Suzanne.
Can you hear me? I never know if this works. Okay. So I have a couple of questions about just the overall purpose of what we're doing here, because a lot of this sounds like these are folks that really we had to talk to before we even started writing the plan. So I'm wondering if these are folks that I've already been talking to, is the timing okay to be put in the past? And if I'm just talking, not doing an official, you know, workshop or something, just kind of called them up and we chatted about it, is that okay?
Yeah, yes. Oh, definitely. It's really a planning, I don't want to say brainstorming, but it's a way for a campus to have talked, as you said, in the past tense, or plan to talk. So you could say, for example, you've already talked to your vice president of academic affairs, so you just put that in. We notified her or him about the fact that we're going to apply for this, and talk to them about, you know, how they recommend we do this or whatever it is, right? Yes. So, again, it's really about helping folks who may never have done this before to think about the big picture and all the potential stakeholders.
Does
that make sense?
So, like, for example, for the VP of instruction, so in order to even start the process, I had to have him sign off on this. So what I just say for the key value proposition, he said in his signature that supported this, or does it need to be more than that?
Nope, that's all.
Okay.
That's all. It's really great that you asked that question, because that is a key part that we want, you know, we want that to accomplish, every campus to accomplish, that they have communicated up and down the levels of administration and bodies on the campus, whether it's the student body or the faculty groups or even the staff as well. Staff are very much a part of this initiative. And so whatever that takes on your campus is a great idea. It's not going to hurt. So that what we want to avoid is that in 6 months when you are receiving an award, that someone says, what award? And I don't know what to do with it. I don't know what to do with it. I don't know. Well, who does it? What? Where? And et cetera, et cetera. Now, there will always be a level of folks not quite understanding certain aspects of it, but it's just trying to make sure that as many of the stakeholders are involved as possible.
Got it. Thank you.
I hope I didn't repeat it too often. Thanks for your question. I appreciate it, Susan. All right, moving on to the next tab. And this is the training tab, training and professional development plan. And again, it's potential stakeholders, and just scrolling down. So, you know, what kind of topics might you be covering? And again, this is just to help you think it through. And then types of training that you could be doing, the number of people that you might invite at a single training. Again, this is flexible. You might think, I'm going to get 20 people at a training, but your first one you get 2 people, and then the next one you get 16, or, you know, this is not set in stone. It's just a way to think it through as you're beginning to implement a project like this. And then, you know, what's your schedule for this? What are your trainers? Who's going to be involved? And the measures of success around that, too. And I'm not going to go through all these different training rows here, but, you know, it could be something you're going to do a message out to all faculty, come to this OER workshop, or come to this workshop whether or not you want to participate, or, you know, whatever that is. Or you might be targeting a specific department like we've listed here, and this does not cover all departments. It's just some idea. And or if you're going to have a training just for the librarians, or, you know, whatever it is. These are just ideas. Not required, but just to help you think that process through as to what you're going to do, since a lot of AB 798 is about professional development, and it works differently on every campus. So, and between the CSU and the community colleges as well. So, again, just a way to think it through and, consider what might work and to speculate on what you're planning to do. And from the perspective of training as well, this might be a new concept around OER and or lowering costs of textbooks. We do have some examples that we've posted to the FAQ page of training organizations that are out there, or some examples of some actual training that other institutions and organizations have posted up on the site. So hopefully you can take a look at those and then incorporate and take the best of anything that might work for you on your campuses as to helping folks become familiar with this project and or the implementation process. So any other questions about training? Any questions about training? Sorry.
I do. I'm sorry. I have lots of questions.
We like questions.
Thanks. On the training, one of the ways that I was thinking about this is having all those folks actually do the training. So I was going to try to enlist the librarians and our academic technology folks to do the training rather than someone else training them. Is that an okay approach for this?
Definitely. Okay. Actually, one thing that I've noticed I just had to do a big literature review for our, we're dividing a report on all this what we've been doing up till now. And it was interesting to see that I've noticed that a lot of campuses, their instructional designers have never been exposed to OER and or digital textbooks. So there might be a need to do something around that, or just to kind of norm them on what's out there. But yes, having them do the training for you is a great idea. Librarians, I mean, they're the experts at their databases and how to find resources and what resources are available and how many multiple copies of a book can a student check out at a, can students check out at a time, you know, what your licensing issues are in the library, and also instructional designers know your learning management system really well and, you know, whatever that entails. So, yes, having them do the workshops or asking them to help facilitate is a great idea. But I would also caution anybody that they might also need to be have a little bit of some orientation around this as well. I've noticed that with the instructional, and that's my area of background is instructional design. I've noticed that sometimes folks are still pretty don't have a complete knowledge of what's available in regards to or what can do with open education resources. Does that answer your question, Susan?
It does, and I hadn't thought of that. Thank you.
No problem. Just ideas. Any other questions about training? Okay. So moving on to the next tab, which is health and support services. Similar concept is to look at the potential stakeholders and you know, type of health and support services. I'm going to look at that field right now. So examples of frequently asked questions posted on the website. It's kind of like what we have, but probably more in depth. Phone number, contact information for a coordinator to get help, reference librarian information to get help, bookstore staff, you know, those kind of folks. Those kind of folks to help with in the various stages of implementation. So that would be, you know, that thinking through who that could be. It could also be when providing information as to when they're available, when is your help desk available, when are the instructional designers available, how much time do they need. You know, if someone puts in a request to the help desk, is it a 48-hour return or, you know, what is that? What metric, response time will there be? Just thinking through those things. And then what metric, again, will you use to measure success in this area? And again, the help features vary quite a bit. But that will be really important because we don't want the faculty necessarily to agree to do this and then to agree to adopt the book and then kind of get flummoxed in the process and they're not really sure who to go to for assistance. Might be kind of an obvious situation, but it's good to think it through. Any questions about health and support services? Okay. Then the next tab is about how you're going to help your faculty discover, curate, or distribute the print and digital materials. Again, looking at the potential stakeholders, and I'm going to scroll down and look at the window that says strategies for finding OER. And so that could be adding a link to your LMS, like you might set up a training course in your LMS and adding a link to the coolfored.org site or putting it on your faculty development page or, you know, somewhere that faculty can get to easily and don't have to remember where it is, including students' organizations to help them discover some of these resources. Although a lot of times I maintain if the instructor is still in charge of selecting textbooks, so it's helpful if the instructor is also included in the discovery and curation process. And I just want to stop there and talk about what we mean by curation. So sometimes there's not one single document, such as a textbook, that works for a single course. So their curation could mean that an instructor uses only one chapter out of one of the OpenStax biology books and then finds some relevant articles in the library that could be helpful for that course might use Khan Academy videos and maybe YouTube videos that are appropriate. So that's what we mean by curation, is kind of sometimes one size doesn't fit all, and so that there might be a need to kind of curate the various topics and the resources that are available. And so a lot of times instructional designers can help faculty with that. Librarians definitely can help with that. That's what we mean by curate. So let's see, potential stakeholders for discovery, you know, attending workshops, following self-directed instructions. Yeah, some people, you know, as you know, your faculty and staff are very busy, so maybe creating some sort of standalone self-directed instructions that they can download and just use at 10 o'clock on a Sunday night when they can't, that's when they have time to do the work but nobody else is available. So, and who to get for one-on-one services and some strategies for curating OER. I gave you some examples there. Strategies for distributing the OER. For example, adding links to the syllabi and into the LMS. And I'm going to stress that because what we've seen in the faculty showcases, some of the feedback of faculty who have adopted OER, is that the students were confused. How do I get to that item? Where was it? My instructor told me about it, but I didn't know where to find it. So the more one embeds links, and you know, a lot of times you can embed links directly to a particular chapter for a particular area, and then the next week or two you add the next chapter's link, again, to sort of provide redundancy for finding resources for the students and accessing them without having too much of a challenge, experiencing too much of a challenge there. The other thing I saw was sometimes students, considering some of the student technology tools that they're using, that making sure that if they're using a mobile device that the tool that they're, the textbook or course material is mobilized relatively well to be used on a mobile device such as an iPad or a phone even. And so what do they do if they can't? One of the complaints I saw of a student was that they didn't feel they could download the PDF. Some of these open textbooks are very large documents. So their computer struggled with downloading the PDF. So taking that into account and thinking through some strategies around that as well. So I highly recommend if you get a chance just to look at the faculty showcases and to see some of the challenges. The faculty showcases on Cool for Ed are set up in three columns. One of them is about the book and about the course. There's a second column, and the third column is the experience by the instructor and the students in the adoption process of the OER that they used in the course. And that's really rich information that might be helpful for you as well. I also put together a little PowerPoint on that recently for the Open Ed Week presentation, and I'd be happy to share that with you. If you're interested, I've kind of compiled some of the challenges and stuff in there. And if you could just type your email into the chat room, and we'll collect those and we'll send that PowerPoint to you if you're interested. Might be helpful, might not be. Let's see, getting print copies. Okay, this is a really important issue. The digital environment we're seeing is basically easy for a third of the students and faculty to adjust to. They're already doing digital in many ways and they're comfortable with it. Another third are willing to go digital if they're saving money, and they will learn how to do it, and they get it. They will persevere. And then there's another third of the students that are still not comfortable in the digital environment. So it's important to think through if instructors are like this. I told you this example of the chem class that 30 sections are going to adopt the Open Textbook, that they make available a link to where the print copy is available. So we know that OpenStax College sells their books on Amazon in print version, so you can link over to Amazon or talk to your bookstore, a lot of bookstores, because we work, like I said, with bookstores all the time. We have a committee where we work very closely with them, will be willing to carry a print copy of an Open Textbook in their bookstores and charge a nominal print fee for them. So that's another thing to keep in mind. Even though students still can get a digital book for free, a third, potentially a third, are still interested in print versions. So something to think about as to how that might look for you on your campus. And so then we also have the measures of success. Again, these are just things to think about and nothing that you're going to be measured on in your application. I just want to make sure that you're thinking this through because this is all new to all of us, and we want to make sure that we don't overlook anything. Any questions about discovery to distribution?
I do. So one of the questions that I'm getting a lot is about the print copies. And so I understand that the books like OpenStax, where there's a PDF and the print is really clear. But for some of the faculty that want to curate, and like you were talking about, you know, using Khan Academy videos and that sort of thing, if you're curating some of those more media heavy, I couldn't quite figure out how those two connect.
Yeah, well, good question, very good question, Susan, I appreciate that. And that there isn't really there. You can't print off a video. But if you do have a student that's in a course that's sight impaired, then it will be important for an alternative, a reasonable accommodation be provided. And the instructor, that's why I want you to include your disabled student services group, because they will be able to address that. And the instructor might have to accommodate that and maybe not requiring that, if that's the case, or there might be a transcript available of that resource, or the disabled students group will be able to create something for the student. So, yes, there's not a print. Yeah, you can't really print a video, obviously, unless you do a lot of screenshots, but I don't think that would really be a valuable tool. But that's where consulting with the Students with Disabilities group on your campus would be really helpful if that's the case. If you have a hearing impaired student in the course, then making sure that those videos have closed captioning available. And if not, then planning to make sure that that happens. YouTube allows one to upload a transcript, but then that requires somebody to create the transcript. And a lot of times it shouldn't really necessarily fall on the instructor to have to do that, but it just depends on how that is set up on a campus. So, yes, thinking that through is very important.
And actually, I was thinking more, not so much for accessibility, because I guess that's a very different question, but I'm thinking more for like the third of the students that you were talking about that like that paper book, because I always give my students the option too, and I know there's a lot that just likes the book, and so I'm wondering how much I should discourage faculty from curating highly media-heavy materials because there's no book possible, or if that's what they want, just let them do it.
Yeah, it's a really good question. That's a very good question. I guess it also depends on the course. Let's say you're teaching Psych 100 or English 100 or some of those, you know, large gen ed courses where you get a lot of students, and it's not like you're teaching a media course on film where a student would be expecting that there would be a lot more media involved. I think it would be important to think through, whether or not one relies heavily on media if the course isn't really meant to be fully media-based. That could be one principle to help guide an instructor on that.
Okay, cool. Thank you.
Yeah. Good question. Thank you. All right, so we're running out of time. I'm just going to hit on the tech facility policy resource. Same idea. Make sure that you think through what kind of technology requirements could be needed for this initiative. And so that could be setting up a listserv or using the campus LMS or, you know, again, notifying those folks that are involved. This is not necessarily what you will have to do, but it's just these are just ideas. What kind of facility requirements do you need a room to meet for your workshop? Or will the reference desk and library be available for questions, you know, all these things that are really just a good thing to think through, potential areas that could be needed in regards to the tech and policy resources. Policy requirements, make sure academic freedom policies are applied to textbook affordability program, meaning that faculty are not required to participate. Those are whatever your campus academic policies are, freedom policies, accessibility policies, we just talked about that a little bit. It could also be requirements, you know, making sure that students have access to computer labs in case they don't have a computer, you know, what kind of things to think through that students will need if they have to have access to their digital textbooks, and then other resource requirements. And this is at the bottom of this page is where you will outline a lot of your requests for funding, in that, you know, you might want to embed within your funding that you're going to spend some time, money on a staff person to help with X stuff, and or you're going to develop a recognition event or professional development workshops or other items, and then that would be what you would total up here. And again, these are just projections, and we understand. And I'm going to skip over to the savings and progress report because I think that's really important. This is where you will list the estimated number of course sections, and as the 8798 plan requires that you have to, if you're going to ask for example, $30,000, you have to designate 30 sections or 30 courses, or, you know, 10 sections of this and 5 sections of this, or whatever it is, has to match for the number of funding, $1,000 increments that you request. And you have to project, based on the cost of the book in your bookstore, what it initially could be, and then what could the potential will be for the if the instructor goes to a certain level. And you can see examples here of different types of materials that the instructor can utilize instead of the previous textbook that has to be at least a 30% savings. And then we look for estimated total cost of savings in for a certain semester, for example, possibly the spring. And then I'm going to scroll over in this plan, in this spreadsheet, because on the last half of it, this is where the reporting that will happen in the future for progress report, we're going to actually ask you to total the cost of course materials, the actual cost savings, the estimated cost of print materials in the bookstore is available, and the actual number of students enrolled. So that's what we will be reporting back to the state. So that's why that's there, and it's kind of hidden. But we wanted to include it on this spreadsheet so that folks know what the goal is for savings. And I think you might have heard, and that might have been discussed in other webinars, that whatever, you know, let's say you ask for $50,000 because you have 50 courses and sections, but not you don't have to spend $1,000 per course per on a single item. You can take that funding and then divvy that up, that maybe 10% of it is going to go towards I don't know what I want to say. You know, maybe 50% of that or 60% will go towards providing professional development workshops, and 10% could go to a staff person that's going to help manage all this, some of their time. Or it could be maybe licensing a product such as a library tool to help faculty with the discovery of and the curation of OER. So it's not, you don't have to, once you have the funding, what you have to do is designate those 50 courses or sections, but then you can determine what you do with that funding. And that's what we're asking you to outline in the tech facility policy resources tab at the very bottom. Okay, so I want to make sure that you have some time to ask questions. Any other questions about this? And like I said, this is not a one-off experience. You have, I'm going to go back to the, I'm going to stop sharing my page here, and I'm going to go back to what we had online, and I'm going to show up. There's my content. Here we go. Sorry. Back to content. Yeah. At the very end of this slide, of these slides, I have that cool4ed@pbl.edu is the email address where you can email me, and I share this information with my boss, Jerry Hanley, who's very actively involved. He's the vice chancellor in the CSU, and then also with Kathy Harris, who's the chair of the council, to make sure that we are available to answer questions as quickly as possible, and then also to provide feedback on campus plans. Any campus can send their plan to us at any time for review before it's submitted June 30th. We hope that it's not on June 29th, so that we have a few days to review it. We want all of our campuses to be successful, all of the campuses in the state, the community colleges and the CSUs. So we want to make sure that we help you get there. So any other questions? And they were all great questions. Thank you, Susan.
One question?
Yes.
Let's say we have a course that maybe we run 20 sections of the course, and we develop OER material for that course, and we're projecting that 20 sections will use it, but let's say we've got a few resistant faculty and actually only 15 of them are willing to use it, or 10 of them are willing to use it. Mm-hmm. So what is that, should we plan for that kind of thing, or how does that mm-hmm. affect this?
Well, great question. So it would be a good idea to, if you have 20 sections of a whatever, that you have the buy-in from the chair and maybe most of the faculty. And if you know that there's just the one or two faculty that are not going to do it, then I would estimate, you know, so let's say we have 2 out of 20, so maybe 18. But if you are not sure and you think they might, you know, they might be interested after they see the whole professional development process and the support, we are going to be somewhat flexible as we realize that people are going to have plans, and then plans don't always work out, so that's okay.
Okay.
Does that answer your question?
Yeah.
Okay. Great, thanks. That was a good question.
Thank you.
Actually, that reminded me of some people. So, as one other question. So, I saw somewhere in the updated RFP that the timeline for adoption was actually not just next year, but the year after. Is that correct, or did I misread something?
So the timeline for adoption is the awards will be coming out to the campuses sometime in the fall. And, you know, the sooner the better, in my opinion, and so hoping that would be September. But then you're already in your fall semester. So you could be implementing the adoption in the fall or the winter quarter or semester if you have one, and the spring, because we are looking for some feedback in at that time in the summer of next 2017. But really, things don't really have to be completed until 2018. But if you're interested and you did it in your in applying for more funds, and there is and with the understanding that we're hoping that everybody applies and there won't be any extra funds, right? That it's gone and everybody is doing great things. But if there are extra funds, which very likely will happen, then we will open the RFP up again, and that will give you the opportunity to apply for more funding. So then you will need to have it done by spring 17. Does that make sense, your implementation?
Gotcha.
But so then you have to show proof that you did accomplish something. Sorry. Go ahead.
So the original application that's going out this June, the faculty has to be using those books sometime in the next school year. Is that correct?
It would be, yes. Yeah, we highly recommend that, yes.
Okay, got it.
And mostly because of timelines, how they work, it would be spring of 17. But you might have really eager faculty that want to go for it in the fall. And then, you know, the funds will be transferred, and then, you know, you will be able to manage those funds however you plan to do that on your campus. If you're providing, you know, grants for workshop attendance or something like that, then you just have to kind of know that you're not going to have the funds in August necessarily. It'll be sometime in the early fall.
Okay, cool. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. And any feedback you all can provide as you're doing this, and any recommendations that you all provide as you're working on this project, we're very open to hearing them, because this is the first time we've done this. Anybody in the state's done this. So we're doing the best with what we know. And we want to make sure that we're considering as many aspects or angles or options as possible. So thank you very much to all of you for being here this afternoon. And again, coolfored@pbl.edu. Send inquiries, questions, plans at any point in time. Thank you for participating. And take care.
Thank you.
You're welcome. I'm going to turn off the recording.